eyes on.
Yeah, that's what. Yeah.
All right. I guess this thing is working.
Yeah, I hear it.
That's the best of light to get. You got some old people in there like me. We need light. Yeah. All right. Well, with no further ado, glad to see so many here on a cold, frigid day like today. That means that you are really serious about, making relationships turn into love. It's an art, much like making grapes turn into wine. We'll get started here. I think everybody should have a handout of some sort.
We'll go. I'll pass around.
Okay, let's get those handouts. A workbook. Most people forget that if you're not telling the truth, you're miscommunicating. Mm-hmm. You're miscommunicating. And this task of telling the truth within the context of our relationship is really challenging because there's a lot of fear with that. You see? That if you tell the truth, there's going to be some consequences. You follow me? And there's a kind of fear there of intimacy and honesty in relationships. But yes, you want a kind of relationship where you're free to communicate, to be truthful, honest. You see? Because no relationship ever become more intimate than the capacity of the couples to tell one another the truth. You see? That's the key to it. It's really the truth. What else? What else?
Harmonious.
Harmony. Yeah, harmony. You see, harmony. You gotta have harmony. Peace. And that's especially the case if you're on some kind of spiritual path or some kind of personal development course. You have to have harmony. Because you cannot grow psychologically and spiritually without a harmonious home. Context, you see. It's not going to work. So harmony. What else?
Cooperation.
Cooperation? It sounds like a wish list. Cooperation.
Well, I was going to say reciprocity, give and take, but is that the same thing?
Same thing. Yeah, reciprocity. That's kind of short and prepared. And so on and so forth. I think you're in the right direction. Now, that's nice, but you have to also see what is the concept of the person you're in a relationship with relative to the relationship. What is their concept of a successful relationship? Therein lies the rub, you see? Now, this is really interesting. We're not going to spend a lot of time on it because each one of these topics is worthy of a much longer discussion. Let me put it in a kind of a micro formula. Your concept of what a successful relationship is going to be based on and related to your concept of yourself. Your concept of what a successful relationship is based on your concept of yourself. Now, for instance, if you have the concept of being just your gross physical body, then a successful relationship for you is going to be based on all of the things that pertain directly to the body, right? Food, right? Must be plenty of food, you must feed, right? Sex, and to some degree, bodily comfort. That's about it. Are you following my argument? Because this is where you at. This is where you at. And the person you're in relationship with, they may be identified more with their minds. And in that case, what they're looking for is intellectual stimulation. They enjoy the arts. They want to have long philosophical, spiritual discussions. And you want to watch a late night show and so forth and so on. You see, there will be a kind of incompatibility. So we'll get back to some of those things a little later. But I wanted to just get your input on your operating concept of what a successful relationship looks like. Let's go to work here. Let's go to page 4 in your workbook. Saying that the single greatest obstacle and threat to having a successful personal relationship that is fulfilling, that is cooperative, that is harmonious, that is intimate, is simply one thing: anger. anger. It is our anger at one another that destroys the possibility for a relationship to blossom and unfold to its highest potential. It just cannot happen. You see? It cannot happen. Why? Because anger is the direct opposite of love. See? When you're angry at somebody, you feel like giving a big hug and a kiss and buying them a new car and a mink coat and all that. When you're angry at somebody, what does that make you feel like doing to the other? Yeah. So anger is the first block, stumbling block that must be overcome if you're going to truly, realistically have a successful relationship that thrives over time, that gets better and better and better. It's like that wine, you see. It never gets old. The older it gets, the sweeter it gets, you see. That's why you can find couples who've been married 70 years and still in love. In fact, they have more love. And if you're not falling into more love with your partner, you need to look at that. Now, I don't have to mention to you that where there's anger, that there's going to be some violence sooner or later. We have an epidemic problem with domestic violence in this country. I think you all know that, right? Mm-hmm. Especially the women folk in here, right? Very often you'll find 4 out of 10 women have been violently handled by their male significant other, you see, in one way, shape, form, or fashion. So we have like an epidemic problem with this mismanaged anger, not only within the context of personal relationship, but all over the place, in the community, on the streets, at work, it's everywhere, you see. And the reason is that usually we don't get that kind of psychoeducation that gives us the ability to manage our emotions. We can get a Ph.D., and you will never learn throughout that whole ordeal how to really control your emotions at all. And of our emotions, anger is the most destructive. That's its purpose. See, anger is a major way of empowering us to destroy that which we perceive as a threat. That's what anger is for. See? So the problem in your relationships, in our relationship that we have with our significant other, is not each other. See, the problem between you and your wife is not, the problem is not you and the problem is not your wife. The problem is the anger. Are you with me? It's the anger is the problem, not each other. You have to always remember that. Otherwise, you'll start blaming the problems on the other, and the other's going to kind of blame you for the problem, and then you know what's going to happen from there, don't you? Right? So you have to understand, whoever you are, an intimate personal relationship with, it's never a problem. Anger is the problem. Anger is the problem. And you have to understand that, you see? So you can follow along as we go here, okay? Now, you know what anger is, you know what the problem is, but we need to say a little bit more about this here. And actually, I've been talking about anger for almost 30 years. Still has not exhausted. It is a very deep, very profound, very pervasive topic. You know, it runs deep. And this would be especially interesting to those of you who are embarking upon a spiritual path or a path of personal development. Because if you can't manage your anger, you're not going to make any spiritual progress whatsoever. Because spiritual progress requires one to have the ability to love. And if you don't have any management of your anger, you will lose your capacity to love, and hence, you cannot grow. It's a profound matter. We're going to get into some of the metaphysics and perhaps even the spirituality of it as we go along. Y'all all right?
Yep.
Y'all can take y'all shoes off, and if you didn't get your nap, I'll lay your head down. It's all right. I'm not offended at all, okay? So let's see what happens here. You get angry. Mm-hmm. Now, if you don't know how to deal with your anger on this onset, you have no skills, that anger is going to escalate, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Make sense? It's not going to disappear. It's going to turn into hate. First, you're angry at the other person. You don't know how to manage that anger. And you're going to start hating that person. You see? Still, if you have no ability to manage your anger, it's going to escalate to another level, right? It's going to turn into something like evil, right? You're going to start having compulsive, obsessive thoughts about how to hurt this woman, so and so, right? How I'm going to rob her, or how I'm going to cheat on her. I mean, you're going to start really getting into some serious strategies to exact your revenge. Right? You're drawing pictures of it in the basement, throwing darts, you're bored in a cauldron of oh, you see what I'm saying? You're putting hex, you're making little boondocks and sticking pins and so forth. So it gets evil.
Contemplating murder.
Contemplating murder. Right. That's right. We call that homicidal ideation. Homicidal ideation. You start thinking about ways to really totally destroy this person because you're perceiving them as the source of your upset, right? You apply seriously, sometimes to the point of sleeplessness, you toss it and turn it, and even in your dreams you can't escape from the bastard. You know what I mean? You're still trying to figure it out. Don't control it at this point. It's going to turn into rage, or what we call super anger. At this point, you see, you're going to start acting out on that homicidal ideation. Before it was just a good idea, you see, but now it takes over, and you're going to act that out. And out of this rage, there will be violence. Every single time. You see, verbal, emotional, financial, all of the kind of violence that we see that go on in relationships, it's coming out of here. Person has, or you have mismanaged your anger to the point where you have no more control of yourself. See, that's the danger about anger. You don't manage it, it's going to happen with you. You'll lose your self-control. You won't have no control of yourself. And we'll look into that in a moment. But the point I'm trying to make here is that there's never enough to ignore your anger. You got to deal with that. And you got to deal with it effectively. Because you'll go from being a nice deacon in the church, might even be the pastor, to a murderer. In a split second, like that, all of your humanity, all of your morality, all of your ethics, all of your education, gone. Just like that. In a moment of rage. Hmm? You see. In fact, both violent acts occur in this country, obviously, is associated with a person being in that state of rage. You see? Rage, anger. You see? Now, here's an interesting thing. When you think about it. Mm-hmm. The effects of anger on you. It's a take a look at that. So anger impacts you across the entire spectrum of your being. There's not a phase or a place or space in your entire total being that is not impacted on by your especially your failure to manage that anger. So let's take a look. Let's see what are some of the effects of this rage, this anger on your body. Have you ever thought about that? High blood pressure. Certainly it's going to raise your blood pressure, right? Because anger is an energy. You see? It's an energy. You see? Biopsychic energy. You see? And it speeds up every metabolic function in the body. Speeds it up. You see? Two. So it's going to move that blood, right? The pressure, right? Now, if your arteries are all clogged, right, you're going to have some trouble, right? So it's definitely going to raise your blood pressure. And let me point out right now, before we go too far, and the reason that it does that, it excites your blood, you see, it creates that pressure, is because anger itself is a secondary phenomenon. It's not the baseline. The fundamental thing going on is fear. Remember, we define anger as nature's way of empowering us to protect ourselves from a perceived threat. Anger is fear-based, right? So you know how it is when you get scared, right? Somebody walks up behind you and says, boom, your heart jumps out of your chest, right? It's the fear. It's the fear. So naturally, that fear-based release of anger is going to affect you because of your blood pressure. You see? Getting nervous, right? So forth and so on. What else? We're not going to exhaust this here, but I want to flesh it out a little bit. What are some of the other effects that anger has on your body? And just think about it. When you get angry, how does that anger show up in your body? You got to know that about yourself. Yes, sir. Your whole breathing pattern changed, right? Hyperventilation. You're breathing up here, aren't you? There's no more diaphragmatic breathing going on. You can hardly breathe because the system is broken, right? You mess around and faint. You ever seen people get so angry they faint? Can't catch their breath. How anger is showing up in your body, you have to understand that about yourself. You see? If you don't understand how your emotions are playing out in your body, mind, then you don't have no knowledge of yourself. Fundamentally, you're ignorant. Doesn't really make a difference how much other stuff you know. Fundamentally, you don't know nothing about yourself. Therefore, you'll never be able to control yourself at all. Yes? Okay, so that makes you fat, right? One of the effects of mismanagement of anger is that you will overeat and you'll get fat, right? Because why? Being angry don't feel good in the body. It just don't feel good. So you got to do something to cover that dis-ease that is in the body. So I got to eat some ice cream or something to feel better. In the body. You're trying to feel better in the body. Because the body is the first point of contact of that anger. Yes. So that's a behavior, right? Overeating. But the outcome of overeating is this, right? Or would you just become unhealthy?
Yep. Might lose weight too, lose your appetite.
Yeah, you become unhealthy. What are some of the other effects on the body when the anger impacts the body? When you get angry, what are you feeling in your body?
It affects your nervous system. You might shake, you might perspire in your hands.
Yeah. It creates tension. Tension. Stress. Adrenaline. Because it releases adrenaline. Adrenaline hits that body. And you shake like a crack. You know what I mean? Got my tool. This place ain't got no insurance. Okay. Tension, stress, because the brain, right, have all of these hormones in there, you know, right? More adrenaline, you know, and all of these things, they start getting released, right? Hormones start moving, right? Because the body is in a
hyper state of vigilance.
What else can happen in your teeth in the body? Yes, ma'am.
Migraines?
Yeah. Why you can suppose that happened?
Just stress.
Stress?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, stress.
Yeah. Yeah. Where there's anger, there's always stress. They're concomitant phenomena. Where there's one, there's the other. Like smoke and fire. Now, what you do with that, how you manage that, your style of dealing with that would be different. Maybe we'll say a little bit about that. Yeah, so you get migraine headaches and all of these kinds of things. What else? And again, we want to exhaust it, but the homework for you, the takeaway for you, is that you got to leave here today and you got to know exactly how this anger is affecting you at the level of your body. You got to know that. You got to know that. You see? There are so many illnesses that are the direct result of stress-based illnesses. And most stress is a result of this fear and anger. You see? Mess you up. You see? And especially important for sisters over here because you got a female body that's delicate. Quick. It's not even designed to handle no stress. Are you with me? And you mess around and you're going to have lumps all in your breast, knots under your arm, fibroids are breaking out all over you. It's going to wreck your menses. You're going to be in premature menopause. You understand? Your iron level is going to fall down. You're going to get all out of whack, your electrolytes. You understand what I'm saying? Mess you up. You see? Mess you up. Quick. Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
And the body, chemical imbalance.
Yeah, chemical imbalances in the body. And the brain, too. You see? It interferes with the brain, making the dopamine and so forth and so on. So you just ain't going to never feel good. You see? That means you're going to be back and forth to the doctors. Back and forth. Well, much, much more. What about your heartbeat? What happens? Right. And so if your heart is flooded with cholesterol and barbecue sauce, you're going to drop dead. You're going to get mess around and kill yourself. You're going to get so angry, you're going to have a heart attack. Mm-hmm. Just that. You see? At a certain age, you know, we gotta stop getting angry. I mean, if you over 60, you gotta get you some good anger management skills because this body gets weak, gets more vulnerable, et cetera, you see? And your body, due to the aging process, is no longer strong enough to tolerate this stress that is simply being generated out of our anger. It will kill you. You will drop dead. So we see that anger has a whole host of negative effects on the body, right? And we can go on and on and on. But the task is you've got to really inventory the effects that your anger has on you. Are you with me? So this is not merely an academic discussion here. Are you with me? Mm-hmm. All of this equals suffering, what the Buddhists call dukkha. You see, pain. It don't feel good. Point of making it that your mismanaged anger don't feel good. And because it don't feel good, you're going to resort to those behaviors by indulging in which you can make yourself feel better at the body. You become a candidate for substance abuse. Foolaholic, sexaholic, chocoholic. I mean, you're going to move into some kind of addiction. Definitely. You see, we know that in substance abusers, that even after they get clean, the next thing we got to deal with is their anger. Because the anger went under them. You see, they were self-medicating to avoid the pain, you see, and the body. Well, this is not the worst of it. It gets worse. Right? and I'm not going to exhaust this here. You all should have this little booklet. You all have this. If not, make sure you get one. Okay, take a phone with you. Because it goes into each of these things a little bit more detail. I'm just summarizing some of that material. So we looked at the body, so that's not good. What about your mind? Because you have a mind. Well, some of us have a mind.
Inability to think clearly.
Okay. The inability to think clearly, right? You lose the ability to for rational thought.
Rational.
Is that right,
Yes.
When anger hits your mind, you become mad. We even use that term, mad. But we mean mad in a clinical sense. You become really mad. You cannot think clearly. You cannot think rationally. It sets that capacity down. What are some of the other effects?
Your mind begins to imagine all the things you're going to do to get back.
Yeah. It creates a kind of obsessive compulsive disorder, doesn't it? OCD. Which means that the mind becomes restless. Is there any more peace in mind?
No.
No?
Right.
Destroys any semblance of peace of mind. You can't be angry and have peace of mind simultaneously. Maybe no, that can't happen. That never happens. You see? It's like darkness and light. They cannot occupy the same space simultaneously. Similarly, you can't be at this upper register of anger and have any kind of peace of mind. That's not happening. You see? That's not happening. You see? What are some of the other effects?
Increase self-concern.
Hmm?
Increase self-concern. You're concerned about you.
Fixation. You become fixated. Ego fixation, I call it. It occurs. Ego fixation.
Depression.
You can't get past that. You can't get outside of yourself. You get closed up. Are you with me? You become in the clinical culture, we call it the alexithymia. You lose the ability to have everything because you're too closed up. Alexithymia sets in. Yes, ma'am?
Your mind replaced.
Oh, yeah. Yes, that's a sort of like that OCD syndrome too, right? But it constantly, right? It gets caught in a doo-doo. It just spins over and over, 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 over. You get a one-track mind. That's all you think about. Yeah. Yes, sir.
And as that cycle continues, so Christ is sabotage.
Yeah. It starts producing all kinds of things, you see. If you get some depression going on, you know, because the emotions is here, right? Rooted in your mind, right? So if some support, you start getting depression, right? Sad. And this part here, when you get fixated on yourself, you see, you get trapped in self-pity. You start feeling you're a victim. And just get deeper and deeper and deeper and deeper. You see? In fact, technically, you become temporarily insane.
Thank you.
You can get a clinician to get you off the hook if you go to court, you know what I mean? And make a good case for yourself that you did something, but you did it in you were temporarily insane. Look, they cut you loose, you know, put you in a psych ward, but they ain't gonna give you a lecture because they understand when your anger has taken over your mind, there is no more sanity. It destroys sanity, make a note. And everything that constitutes sanity, that's destroyed. Destroyed. You're no longer sane. True? And out of that state of insanity, you'll kill your kids, you'll kill your wife, kill your siblings. You definitely will kill your husband.
That's what I'm talking about.
Yeah. In fact, 65% of all homicides in this culture occur within the context of these so-called significant relationships. You got a much better chance of being killed by one of your significant others than you do by some GD out of Chirac. True. Because think about it, these are the people you get to regret the most frequently. You don't get into that, right? Because who are you getting angry at? People that are in some kind of level of relationship with you. And if it's a husband, wife, or so forth and so on, that's a close relationship. There's a great challenge there. And if you don't have it, you will wake up and kill the one man next to you. You know what I mean? But if you get a good attorney, if you get you a good psychiatrist, they can get you off the hook. But if you don't have that kind of money, then I recommend you probably want to start practicing this. Okay? Any other obvious impacts that anger has on your mental functions that you can think of? Again, look at yourself. See, the key here is to focus on yourself. Just remember your last occasion where you got angry at somebody. And now reflect and see. And you can do that. You can reflect in hindsight. And see. See, because if you can't see this in hindsight, you're definitely not going to see it at the moment of impact. Are you with me? Do not kid yourself, right? You can't see this in hindsight. You will not see it because anger strikes in milliseconds and it's gone. Really quick. Really quick. You got to see this about yourself. See? Now just think back. Last time you got angry with somebody, how did it affect your mind? What started happening inside your mind? Did you notice some of this stuff started happening? Did you notice something that is not yet distant or so forth? Yes, my dear.
Weight loss?
Yeah, that'll go back to the body, right? Because sometimes you can become so depressed or so fixated, right, that you can't even think about meeting the needs of the body. You see? Because your mind is so, in such turmoil, you see. The spiritual tradition, we call those kleshas. Kleshas is a Sanskrit word, it means turmoil. So when you make it like that, you're not going to look to get you some hamburgers or french fries. You're trying to kill somebody. You know what I mean? Right? And even if you did, you couldn't process, because one of the things we did put here is, if you'll notice that the impact that anger has on your body, one of them is shuts down your digestive system. Yeah. Shuts it down. Doesn't it? Right? Because the energy now that is wasted in our digestive system, remember that digestion consumes about 70% of the energy that we derive from food and so forth. But we don't need that energy to be digested on food. We need it to go to the feet, the hands, the weapons, right? So it shuts it down, right? So clearly, when you're in this state, you're not thinking about that. You see? Hunger disappears. Hell, pain disappears. When you're angry and in that fit of rage in your mind, you punching walls, breaking your hands, stuff, you don't even feel it. You see my point? It's amazing. It's amazing. All right, let's speed up a little bit because time is of essence here. I apologize and from the onset for not being able to cover everything. So I hope you will forgive me. That's why we give you the book and the websites. There's videos and there's people in the room that can you can follow up with, that can hold your hand with you and walk you through more and more of this argument here. And certainly, I don't expect you to just sit there and believe everything I'm saying. It's not that kind of show, you see. All I ask that you do is to consider the argument. Just consider it, you see. And then come away with your own conclusion, your own understanding. I don't have all the answers up here, you see. And my answers are my answers. You have to find your answers. You have to solve your problem. You see? Nobody can understand for you. That's your work. You see? So, one last area. You looked at the body, looked at the mind. Briefly, just briefly. Anybody got a soul? Y'all got some? Okay, you three people. You want to look and see how anger affects you spiritually. So we have spiritual faculties. Like we got mental faculty and bodily faculty, we have spiritual faculties. You see, there are certain kinds of human behavior that is a reflection of a healthy operation of your spiritual faculties. There's similarly certain signs that you are able to mentally operate in a healthy way. You see, that's what the DSM is all about. You know, psychiatry, psychology measures that. How well your psychological faculties and equipment are operating. You see, you're depressed all the time. That means something wrong with you. You got mental problems, emotional problems. It means that there's something wrong with your faculties. Similarly, there are spiritual faculties, you see? How does anger impact you? Spiritually.
You can't forgive.
Yeah. You can't forgive. You lose your capacity to forgive. Because forgiveness is a spiritual act, you see? Nature wired us in such a way, I mean, this body, mind, this thing is something, really. It's fully equipped to do this thing called life. Perfectly designed just for this. And it gives us these faculties, you see. So even when you're angry, when you're obsessed, fixated with taking revenge on somebody, you have another faculty, if you don't let that anger eat it up, that gives you the ability to forgive the other for their trespasses against you. Not that you condone it what they did. You forgive others for your own sake. It's a refusal to drag this anger around the rest of your damn life. Miserable, can't sleep, you know, full of homicidal ideation, no peace of mind, you forgive and restore health to the mind. It's a spiritual thing. Anger shuts that down when it reaches a level. You indulge in anger so often, so frequently, you're habitually angry now. You lose this capacity. You can't forgive nobody. You're full of grudges. You don't forget shit. You understand? You carry it around with you all the time. You cradling in it. You nurturing it. You understand? You show it to everybody you see. Look and see how wrong people done did me. Girl, let me tell you about how he did me. You understand what I'm saying? You brag about it. Nobody has been more mistreated than me. It is sick. It is absurd. You see? It's the result. You done destroyed your capacity. One of your spiritual capacities. One of your spiritual faculties is not operating. You see? You follow what I'm saying? What are some of the other effects that this unmanaged and mismanaged anger produces?
Lack of empathy and compassion.
Yeah, he's coming from here, compassion. Empathy. You don't have nothing to live with nobody. Can't do it. I'm angry.
You see what I'm saying?
Angry. Chest it down. It could be your wife, your husband, your children, your mother, your father. Make no difference. People who you should have empathy for at that moment. You don't care about nobody but yourself at that moment. You see, closed up. Spiritual effect. Anger affects you spiritually. You see, in the Bible, they talk about anger some 400 plus occasions. In Buddhism, that's all they talk about is anger. Pleasure, anger, ill will toward others is the source of much of our human misery. You see? It is something, the inability to forgive, the lack of compassion, empathy, the ability to take other people, feel it into consideration. Anger sets that down. Can you love?
No.
Can you love?
No.
No. No love is happening. You see? No love is happening. Jesus said something over 2,000 years ago, very profound, great psychologist, great insight into human nature. And he was saying, you do all of these things. You forgive others. You show compassion for others. You have empathy for others. You love others, not merely for the sake of the other. Yes, it's to some extent,
yes,
it's for their benefit, but not ever exclusively for the sake of the other. You love, you show compassion and empathy, you have all of these spiritual qualities toward others. Not really for the sake of others, but for the sake of not losing your capacity to have them. Are you following my argument? That which you don't use, you what?
Lose.
Now, if you don't love, you lose the capacity to love.
Yes.
You don't show compassion, you lose the capacity
yes.
to have compassion. You don't forgive, you lose the capacity to forgive. That's a messed up life. That's a miserable ass life. You just carry grudges all over the place. You know what I mean? It's cancerous. Are you with me? You done lost your capacity to forgive those who trespass against you. Jesus pushed the envelope. He said, this is just not pertaining to your significant other. You know my wife, my children. He said, throw your enemy in there. It's profound. Why? You love him. So that you don't lose your capacity to love. If once you lose your capacity to love, you can't live. Life ends for you. You're like the bellows, Kabir Sahib says, of a blacksmith. You breathe in, you breathe out, but technically you did. Ain't no joy in your life. Ain't no celebration coming from your life. There's no joy. There's no bliss. Anger is. Eating it up. You become bitter, sarcastic,
cynical.
Right?
Cynical.
A misanthrope. You hate people. You're not being around people. You become antisocial. You become sociopathic. Are you with me?
Yes.
I'm going to start beating you over.
That's right. It's profound. It is profound. So we just looked a little bit at the overall impact that this mismanaged anger, particularly at the level of super anger and rage, will have on you across the spectrum of your being. Much more can be said about it, but we're trying to clip along at the same time. Where am I at here? Let's go to page 5 here. Because here you got to look at your triggers. You got to page 5, I don't know what it's in your workbook. Part of this knowing thyself, you see, in every great wisdom tradition, it has always been advised that before you do anything else, before you try to know anything else, know thyself. This admonition has come down since time immemorial and high African culture, you know, Egypt and pre-Egypt. Emphasis was on knowledge of self. And the rise of Greek philosophy, know thyself, know thyself, know thyself, know thyself, you see. So you got to know yourself, you see. Now, the kind of knowledge that we're talking about here is what they call emotional intelligence. Emotional intelligence, or EQ. In ancient times, in the psychology of education, we thought that your IQ was the single greatest predictor of your ability to have success. You see, whether on the job or in your relationship, etc. But upon closer examination, it was discovered that's not it. See? EQ, emotional intelligence. The intelligence to manage your own emotions, that skill set, is the most important skill set. The greatest failures in the world and in relationships are people that cannot get along with other people. It's a profound thing. The inability to interact harmoniously with other human beings, what the African ancestors call ma'at. Ma'at. If you can't get along harmoniously with other human beings, what do we mean by harmoniously? In a way that is non-violent, psychologically healthy. If you can't get along with other human beings, even one other human being, you will fail. You'll go to the job, you can't get along with co-workers, right? What's going to happen to you? Huh? Can you come up on my job and fight with the other employee? Slowing down production. I'm fired. Can you stay mad, fighting, complaining all the time? What's going to happen? We'll divorce your ass.
You got to go.
Right now. That's harmony. You cannot interact harmoniously with other human beings. Because we have already seen that when anger hits the mind, you get stuck on your ego. An ego fixation arises. You're stuck on you. You can't pull other people in. You have no empathy. You don't factor them in. It's just me. What I want. You follow what I'm saying?
Me, myself, and I.
Polypsyche. You know what I mean? Split personalities, all kinds of things. It's emotional intelligence. Right? So now one of the things that you have to have is you begin to develop and cultivate some emotional intelligence. You got to find out what are your triggers. Now this is really interesting. There are certain things that triggers your anger. Have you ever thought about it? Because the person living with you knows exactly what your triggers are. Because again, when a person gets angry, it's like being in a boxing ring. You remember Ali, he would start talking about Joe Frazier, Mama, and all that stuff, and Joe Frazier get mad and stop boxing, right? He just swing, right? Ali just boxed. Knock him out. You see? Or on the basketball court, we talk to trash to each other, talk about your mom and you can't hit no more. You know what I'm saying? Right? Well, something like that happens, you know, triggering you. You get angry, right? That person got you under their control.
That's the easiest person to control is the person who is angry. It is so easy. It's like you can play with them like a puppet. You know what I mean?
Bilal and I, when we were little boys, well, mostly Bilal, I did. And I discovered that early in life, we'll go by the basketball courts, right? And the big boys will be there playing, right? And we'll stay on the sideline, right? And we commenting on the game, right? And so I'll turn to Bilal, and Bilal turned to me and said, did you see how he just pushed Woody out of the way? He just knocked him down like Woody when he ain't playing. Now, Woody's hearing this, right? We're instigating. And Willie heard that and he's in my head. You see, he started doing his self-talk and the fight would break out. You know, it was a superpower. You know, it was like doing a Siddhi, a superpower. We were thrilled. But the point is that when you don't know your triggers and other people do know, right, you could be easily instigated. Easily knocked down. Are you with me?
Yes.
Easily knocked down. And that's what the police do. One of the things that used to occur in our community, in our culture, when you, especially young black males, you were taught how to control your anger out here on the street. You see, because the racism is real here. Right? And so when you get pulled over, you got to know how to yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. You don't hold court in the street. And then you come home unshot. Are you with me? But the police know how to provoke you. Pull your pants down. Put your hands up. Embarrassing you. And all that stuff make you angry, right? And you lose control. Now they got you. You resist an arrest. It's a felony. Now you can't get a job. You know what I'm saying? Back in the day, young black males were taught that skill. Didn't make them coward, they understood. Control it. Transform it. It's energy. It can be used. Like fire. Fire has a legitimate use, right? You can do amazing things with fire. If you know how to handle it, right? If you don't, you'll burn yourself up, right? That energy that the thing is just like that. It's just like that. It's about transforming. You see? So your trigger, so what are some of the things that trigger your anger? I have an ideal here, right? So why don't you take a minute, check that out. Take a minute or two and check that out.
All
And be honest in your assessment. Don't exaggerate one way or the other. You know what I mean? Just honest. You see, with yourself, be honest. Just be honest. Because you're trying to know yourself. So there's no reason to lie to yourself. Lie to me. Lie to the person sitting next to you. Don't ever lie to yourself. You will lose your sanity. Better. Tell yourself the truth about the things that triggers your anger. Because that's the first step to medicine. You gotta know what triggers you. Honest. And everybody gets angry. You see, you don't keep on getting angry until you become enlightened. You see my point? But that don't be a minute for you. It's a gesture for your attention. It makes you angry when people do certain things. Maybe when you don't get what you want, maybe it's when people keep you waiting, when people treat you unfairly. You see, based on your concept of what is fair, as if the whole world is operating off of your concept of fairness. And they do something wrong according to who? You. And they laugh at you, mock you. They do something stupid. You see, give you a problem that you can't solve and thus expose the absence of your so-called brilliant mind. You follow what I'm saying? Do not show your respect. Don't live up to your expectations. I mean, I think I covered everybody in the room. Check it out. Check out the ones. Okay? How many have more than five? Okay, you're in some serious trouble. You're in some serious trouble. You meet me after class. Oh, God. Look at number two. And this is for you to take. So you don't get a chance to really do it as thoughtfully as I'm asking you to do now. Do it thoughtfully when you get home. Really, no fooling. Where do you tend to get angry at the most? And the last time you were angry, what angered you the most?
You got to know this about yourself. You got to know this about yourself.
What are your triggers? And when you look at all of those triggers, basically, they all can be collapsed into the first one.
Basically, you see?
When you can't get your
right. Fundamentally.
Whenever you can't get your way, it frightens you.
And then, this is interesting. You got to look at the psychodynamics here.
Whenever you can't get your way,
it scares the hell out of you.
Because you put in all this effort to get your way in order for you to be what? Oh, boy, y'all all right.
To be happy.
Now, what could be more frightening than the possibility of not being happy?
That's scary stuff because we are all wired and impulse to be happy.
What everybody in this room is doing and everybody out there, all sentient beings, human and otherwise. You're just trying to be happy. Bottom line. Now everybody got their own strategy about how to go about doing that, you see? But you are wired. We are impulse to be happy. And we come up with ways by implementing, we are convinced that we will be happy. And when that strategy is frustrated or interfered with, that's some scary stuff. Now when I get scared, what's the next thing I'm gonna get?
Anger.
Right, right. That's gonna generate me some anger. Because I'm angry because you messing with my strategy by which I'm trying to get happy. And I need to be happy because I'm never happy enough. You see, when I say that we are impulse to be happy, I mean happiness with a capital H, not lowercase. We're impulse to be absolutely happy. Happy with no need to do anything else for the sake of being happy. Absolute fulfillment, absolute satisfaction. A happiness that does not wane, does not come and go. With it, we want the real deal, permanent happiness. You see? Now we'll settle for less very often. A pleasure here, a pleasurable moment there. But that's not what we're looking for. You see? We want absolute, utter, and complete happiness. A happiness that is not dependent upon anyone or anything else. You see? You want to become free. We're going to talk about that. You see?
Free.
Of your psychological dependencies on this and that for the sake of being happy. It's an insult at the deepest level. You with me? You want to be free of that. So we're all searching for ways to be happy. And we done came up with figured it out, we done plotted it, we done thought about it. And we decided that, boy, if I can do this, then I'm going to be utterly, totally happy. And somebody gets in the way of that.
Mm-hmm. That's scary.
Oh, you ain't playing. You need to be happy. You see my point? They're interfering with that. joke. You all follow my argument?
You can't get your way.
But very complex at the same time. So this not being able to get your way can take many forms. Those are some of the forms that it can take. You see my point? Those are some of the many forms that this fundamental trigger
takes.
It is amazing. It is amazing. So, firing out your triggers. That's insight that you have to have. So much more can be said about that. Let's go to page 6. Y'all all right? Now, what makes these triggers effective? This is another way of saying, what really makes you angry? I mean, what are the psychodynamics? What's the physics underlying that phenomenon of anger? And we already looked and seen that you're going to get angry, but you don't know how to manage it, you're going to go there, right? So it's something that we got to look at. Well, it starts with your attitudes. Now this is really interesting, right? So in the little handbook, you can read more about it. I'm just going to kind of gloss a little bit. But your attitudes, what's an attitude? Go ahead. It had a lot to do with the way you think. What say you?
What you believe about yourself.
It could be what you believe about yourself. Don't give it an answer. But the
conclusion you come to
about. Look at them showing off about it. your attitude is that which predisposes you to act or react in a certain fixed pattern. It's a priori. You see, before the event happened, you are already conditioned to respond to it a certain way. Are you with me? So, and these attitudes that we have are about life, about others, and about ourselves. These attitudes are the source of our beliefs, of course, and our expectations as well. Now here's the interesting thing. Most of our attitudes about all of this kind of important stuff were formed before the age of 7. Before the age of 7. Your childhood. And see, your adulthood rests on your childhood. Your childhood does not psychologically disappear. You see, your adulthood is standing on it. It is your basement. It is your foundation. You see, it is what is often generating your reactions at a very subconscious level. You don't even know it. You see? Now, since our attitudes are these conclusions that we have come to about life, about others than ourselves before the age of 7, okay, how intelligent were you by the age of 7? How much wisdom did you have? Did you have any? Your brain had not even developed the prefrontal cortex. It's not possible. Your prefrontal cortex, to give you the ability to do critical thinking, that don't even come on board until adolescence. You're 7 years old. Are you with me? And yet these are conclusions that you come to about life. You see? Now let's say if one of the triggers on your, that triggers your anger, that you become angry whenever people don't treat you fairly. All right, but it's fairness based on the concept of a 7-year-old kid. Are you with me? So we're 7 years old, right? And mama gives you 2 cookies, and she gives me 1 cookie. That's unfair. But I didn't understand. Mama gave you 2 cookies because you got all A, gave me 1 cookie, even though I got all else.
supposed to be the same. Mm-hmm. You see? It's a childish concept of fairness.
So you carry this, right? You don't have a concept of merit. You see my point at all? You don't understand merit is a factor in rewards. You follow me? You gave her two, you didn't give me two. Now you grow up with a problem with your mom and you gotta go to a therapist, right? You pay $185 an hour for 10 years to get your mom issues reduced. So we gotta repair you. But the point I'm making is that you enter into adult reality operating out of the childish conclusion about life. And you're walking around here thinking that life should be fair. What are you talking about? There should be no unfairness in the world. What's wrong with you? There's 7 billion people on this planet. And you expect that every one of those 7 billion people on this planet to treat you fairly? This is absurd. Much of our anger, folks, is simply the result that we have not grown up. You've grown older, and you ain't grew up. And you got to grow up. You follow me? You got to grow up psychologically and emotionally. You got to become mature. So much of our anger is a result of our immaturity. I know this, you don't like this, but I got to tell you the truth. Immaturity. You'll be 65 years old and still immature. It's not chronological age here. Are you with me? Psychological. And so you're full of should. But it should treat me fair. No, what are you talking about? So you can look and see. Don't take my word for it. Just review your boxes that you checked. So, look at the boxes you checked. I get mad as hell when somebody keep me waiting. What now, you expecting that people are going to drop everything they doing so that you don't have to wait? Are you insane? Now you mad at the bus because the bus pulled off. It didn't even wait for me. Bus ain't even wait for you. Let's get with that. You understand? The plane took off. It didn't even wait for me. I was only an hour late. They should have waited. What's wrong with you? You're 7 years old somewhere. You have not grown up. Are you with me? You're trying to do adult life and living with the mind of a child. Can't go over. When somebody do something wrong, you see? Makes you angry. Oh, you think everybody should do something always right.
What is this? It's criminals in this place. You understand what I'm saying? There's some criminals in this room. People gonna do wrong. That's reality.
Are you with me? It makes you angry. I mean, look and see what you check. When people laugh at me, well, that's a big one because they laugh at me and that undermines my sense of who I think I am. Mm-hmm. You see? But I think that I'm always this in a bag of shit, and I'm this and I'm that. They're laughing at me. You see? It diminishes my ego. You see? You're going to find that that's a kind of secondary base factor that underlies these triggers. You see, whenever who you think you are is not validated by others, you get angry. We call it ego diminishment. So it's two things that you have to focus in. They're related. One is these childish attitudes that you have about life, about others and yourself that you have carried over from childhood and never corrected them. The second one is ego dimension. A lot of times that has a lot to do with our neurotic reaction to how people interact with us, right? Because see, you have a ego. Your ego is a concept, the concept of self. It's a concept you have of yourself. It's just some stuff you have invented about yourself. Your ego consists of a bunch of qualities and characteristics that you have arrogated to yourself for the sake of impressing other people. Are you with me? Basically. I'm not saying don't have one, but don't get it confused. You see, that's your persona, your mask. You know, in ancient Greek theater, they wore the mask, they put on the mask to depict each emotion from the distance from the stage, and the audience was so great, et cetera, et cetera. That's your persona. It's your self-made concept of yourself. It's a self that you invent out of thin air, merely for the sake of impressing other people in order to get their attention. Basically. And it's pretty subjective. Nobody knows who this self you're talking about is. We can't see, touch, taste, smell, or feel it. It is 100% subjective. It's made out of the same stuff that your dreams are made of. You see, like you dreamed something last night, and then he comes to the one. What do you think about that dream? Then you see, how do you see you in your dream? It's your dream. It's subjective. You see, same way your concept of who you think you are. It's made out of the same stuff that dreams are made out of. And can't nobody see it. Can't nobody interact with you on the basis and validate it. Because we don't know what you do. We can't see it. And whenever we do act in a way that don't validate your imaginary concept of who you think you are, you get angry. Follow what I'm saying? But nobody can see that. How can we validate what we can't see? In fact, we create imaginary concept of you. Are you with me? Because we don't know who you are either, so I superimpose an image on you. I don't know who you are. I can't know who you are. But since nature abhors a vacuum, I fill that vacuum with an image I create of you. And then that's what I relate to. That's exactly what we do in our relationships. There's never two people in a relationship. It's always four. It's you, right? Right? And then there's the other, right? So there's you, then there's your image, your persona, there's the other person persona, and they self, right? And then, I should say that it gets complicated, and then A is going to have an image of you, and you're going to have an image of A. You see, I get maybe eight people. This is a copy of this. Because a person is always responding and reacting to you on the basis of the image they have of you.
Yes.
Not the image you have of yourself. Make a note. Make a note. It ain't never about the image you have of yourself. It's the image we got of you. And that's what we're reacting to. And that image we have of you is just guesswork. It's just based on pure speculation. Because I said, I don't know who you are. Just like, you don't know who I am. It's all image. It's all ego focused. You see? And one of the tasks of relationship is acquiring a kind of profound understanding and knowledge that transcend these superimpositions. We'll get to that in a minute. That's the art of it all. Do not show me respect. That's an interesting one. See, we're going to talk more about that, so I'm going to leave that alone. And so you can see the mask was sabotaging my happiness. All right, let's move on, folks. We got a long way to go here. I'm doing on time. We need a break. Y'all need a break. Y'all want to get some watch room break? Or we can keep piling through. Or you can move it. Go on your home recognizance if you sort of please. Okay? So our wrong attitudes then toward life toward others and toward ourselves is what makes us angry. What I'm suggesting, folks, is something very radical. Okay? So hold on to your seat. What I'm suggesting to you is that don't nobody make you angry. You make it yourself. Anger is your own activity. You're doing that shit to yourself. And nobody doing nothing. Are you with me? It's your attitude. You're creating your own anger. You're pinching yourself and looking all around trying to find out. You make yourself angry. Do you understand this? See, this is important. Because as long as you think that other people are the sources of your anger, you remain dependent upon what other people do for the sake of being removed from you. Understanding you are making yourself angry empowers you now. Are you with me? Because if I'm making myself angry, right, messing up my body, messing up my mind, destroying my soul, if I'm doing that to myself, then I can stop that thing. Right? But if he's doing it to me, that's a problem now, right? How to get him to stop messing up my body, mind, and soul. You're in trouble. Are you with me?
Yes. Now, is empowerment a kind of freedom?
Empowerment is still not freedom per se, but it paves the way. Are you with me? Because you got the right view of a thing. You see, it's like with any problem. Every problem to be solved requires that you understand the problem. Right? You can't solve a problem if you don't even understand it. Are you with me? And if you understand the causes of your anger is your own attitude that you have about life, about others, and self, that you formed when you were 7 years old. Operating in your 50-year-old body. Yeah. Are you with me? Even after 2 or 3 Ph.D.s, the kid in you is still running your life. It's sad. So you got to go into it, you see. See, so your anger is a gift. Your anger is like a guru. Your anger will shed a light on these dark parts of yourself. Follow your anger. It will tell you much about yourself. You see, we're talking about self-knowledge, right? Just look into your anger. Investigate the nature of your anger, and you will gain a lot of knowledge about yourself. Tremendous knowledge. Because it says something about you. It don't say anything about life. You see? See, if life was the cause, if the cause was life in the objective sense of the word, right? If you're the source of my anger, misery, objectively, causally, in the sense like in physics, chronically, then you should be the cause of my misery too, right? But you're not. Do you see my point? It's me. Life is the same for everybody. Make a note. The world is the same for everybody. This is just one world here. It's the same world that the Buddha lived in. It's the same world that Mahavira lived in. It's the same world that any saint sage lived in. Same places, same weather, same seasons, right? And they were blissful, you miserable. You blame the world, it ain't the world, it's you. But this is called radical responsibility. So a lot of people, that's scary. Because you don't want to be responsible. You want to be able to blame somebody else and keep yourself in that victim's mode. Are you with me? It's your emotions. You understand? They're your emotions. You should be in charge of how you feel, not somebody else. Don't you think? I mean, don't you think? Yes, sir.
I'm going to say, based on what y'all were saying, sign,
you know,
be a sign.
Wouldn't it be a sign of him? Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah. All of these conclusions that take the form of our beliefs about ourselves, because even the belief you have about yourself, you didn't create that. That's feedback that you got from your parents. Mm-hmm. They told you, oh, you're such a smart little girl. You're such a smart little boy.
And you internalize that. Are you with me? Oh, you're a bad little boy. Can you internalize that? But it ain't ever been your doing. It's conditioning. You see? You got 25,000 plus hours of parenting operating in. And you know, some of our parents are crazy, right? I mean, y'all know that, right? We love them, bless their soul, but some of the parents, yeah, they ain't got no. They told us all kinds of things that weren't true. And see, we're in such an age where we're innocent. And we believe these parents. Everything they say is like gospel. Mm-hmm. So they tell you, Santa Claus gonna come tonight, get in the bed. And we believe it's really a Santa Claus. True. They tell you, well, we'll put your tooth under the pillow, and we put that in. You believe it. Because you had no defense against that falsehood. You had no discriminative faculty. You had no ability to discern the distinction between what is true and what is not true. You were totally dependent on your parents. And they told you all kinds of things about yourself. You see? You ain't gonna be shit when you grow up. You're gonna be just like your dad. You get on my last nerve. You make me so sick of tying you. You don't believe that too, that I'm no good. I'm a pain in somebody else. You understand what I'm saying? Your beliefs about yourself, you didn't create those. They're just extensions. You might have decorated them some, polished them up some, but fundamentally, they have been passed down to you. You don't know yourself. So at a deeper level, if we were going to the spiritual dynamics here, you have to examine what you believe about yourself and see if that's true. Where you come from? How you walk, how you tie your shoe, how you talk, your speech. You're manufactured. You're a product. You're conditioned. And the whole task of spiritual development is to become deconditioned, to know your real self. Because that's not your real self. That's the self your mom and dad, your society, your television, your teachers, and the rest of the community made. Because it wasn't just your mom and your dad. Everybody helped had a hand in creating you. You're Frankenstein, you see? The teacher created a little bit about you. The coach created a little something about you. Everybody that you came in contact with left some kind of imprint. The village raised you. You're made by the environment. You see, with a little nurture. You see, it's something for it. This is what the Dogon people in West Africa call sogayi, deep knowledge. You see, knowledge of yourself is the deepest knowledge. You can know quantum mechanics, you can know all kinds of stuff, but if you don't know yourself, fundamentally, you're ignorant, fundamentally. And what is the proof? You can't find happiness. You're an amateur. That's why you have happiness. You're amateurs. You don't understand yourself enough to be happy. Are you with me? True?
True.
Let me get behind this thing. I'm going to talk from behind here. All right, let's look at a little bit more. So you come to certain conclusions about life. Blah, blah, blah. You come to certain conclusions about others too. What's the conclusion you came to about other people? I mean, reflect on that, man. You need to understand how this operates. What conclusion did you come to about the opposite gender? What conclusion did you come to about people of different races? What conclusion did you come to about others? How do you see the other? It depends on how you were raised. If you had an overprotective parent whose style of parenting was overprotective, and tell you, don't you be playing with them other kids, just stay away from other kids. Now you scared of the other. how you gonna have a successful relationship with others? You scared to death of others. It's not gonna work. Others are dangerous.
shaped me. But you have come to certain conclusions about others. And you have come to certain conclusions about yourself. All of them become ultimately what I call your ego mythology. So just a myth. Myth. None of this. None of this. And you got to find yourself out. You got to find out who am I for real. What's my original base? You see my this and all of these childish ways that we're still operating out of by in our attempt to be happy. You see all these childish ways that we're still up to for the sake of being happy. They're all failing. They're not working. And if you're just a little bit intelligent, just a little bit sensitive to looking at the outcome, then Jesus wouldn't have to tell you that. You got to put them away. Jesus, all the ministers said that when I was a child, I thought like a child, I act like a child, right? Right?
Right.
But when I become a man, when I become a woman, I have to what? Put away them childish ways. Got to make that transformation. And that's hard because you had all those childish ways, and that's what you called me. That's what you're calling myself. It's just a bundle of your childish ways. Jesus, Mary, Mrs. said, you got to put that away. That's required. That's prerequisite. The process required that. You got to put it away. See, but you're still trying to be a kid and be grown. How that going to work? You're double-minded. You're split. You're in conflict. You have an inner conflict. You see? Follow what I'm saying? It's profound, folks. You see? So you got all kinds of false conclusions. You got a few that might be right, you see? But most of them are wrong. How right can they be? You were 7 years old somewhere. And you're still clinging to that stuff. You see? You got to let it go. And it's difficult, I agree. It's traumatic. In the East, we call it tapasya. Tapasya, that means fire. It's like going through fire. What you have to do with gold, you know, put it in the crucible, heat it up, burn out all those impurities. In Christian philosophy, we call it purgatory, purification. Got to get purified. That's going to hurt. You see, it's a birth. You see, Jesus talks about being born again. That the second birth is not physical, obviously. Nicodemus didn't understand that. I hope y'all understand that too. Right? Okay. It's a psychological transformation, so, spiritual transformation. But like your first birth, it hurts. You see, like your he had to come down through that little tiny tomb. You can't even imagine how much that hurt. In psychology, we have birth trauma. You know what I mean? It still shows up. You see, it's profound. Similarly, just spiritual rebirth, psychological rebirth, that's one way. But the ego got to be transcended. You got to let it go of your childish ways. You got to let go of what you call me, which is really not you, which is really fabricated. Created. He's following. Composed. Y'all all right?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't want to make nobody mad. All right, let's keep moving. We're on page 6, right? So, naturally, when you don't know yourself, you become vulnerable to becoming self-deluded. Self-deluded. Because you don't know yourself. Self-delusion is when you are clinging to a belief about yourself. That is totally contrary to the evidence surrounding. I'll repeat. Self-delusion is when we cling to beliefs about ourselves in the face of overwhelming evidence to the contrary. Are you with me? We're deluded. You see, the reality that's around us is not confirming our beliefs about ourselves. We're deluded. See? Again, the ego simply arrogates to itself all of these qualities and virtues that in reality we don't possess, right? I get along well with other people. No, you don't. You've been in 12 different relationships in the last 6 months. You can't even get along with one person. What are you talking about? You see my point? You're deluding yourself. I'm brilliant. You know what I mean? I'm smarter than Albert Einstein. You know what I mean? Okay, and you so smart, why aren't you happy? You so smart, how come you haven't figured out a way to be happy? You see? You understand what I'm saying? I'm honest, truthful. Yeah, but nobody's looking. You're deluded. You're simply clinging to qualities and virtues and beliefs about yourself that are completely contrary to reality. Now, one of the major forms of this kind of self-delusion takes here, right, is what we call falsophobia. Falsophobic is the belief that nothing wrong is ever your fault. It's never your fault. It's always somebody else's fault. You see? But it's never your fault. You're falsophobic. You are afraid to acknowledge the fact that you are very often the cause of something going wrong. Are you with me?
Yes.
It's your fault sometimes. But you can't handle that because that contradicts what you believe about yourself. That I'm perfect. Who are you kidding? Nobody's perfect. True?
True.
We all have imperfections, shortcomings, and faults. True?
True.
And it's only rational to understand that sooner or later, our imperfections, shortcomings, and faults are going to become a legitimate basis for somebody's grievance with us. True?
True.
True. But you fought the phobia. Which means you think everything you do is perfect. And that people do never have a legitimate basis for presenting a grievance against you. How could they? You follow what I'm saying? Because I'm perfect. You are deluded. Are you with me? Came from your mom and tell you, you're such a sweet little girl, you're such a nice little boy. Oh, you're such a good little boy, you do everything. You understand? You're still operating out of that.
Well, it seems like the fear, too, of being wrong is society. It's a big deal. You can't be wrong in this society.
Yeah.
It's always ridiculed.
It's always ridiculed. And it's always a threat to that ego, right? And so it's like a contract, you know what I mean, with America. But nobody acknowledged the lack of our individual perfection. You know what I mean? Let's just lie to each other. It's an agreement. But the reality is that, falsophobia, the distorted relationship. Now we get into the stuff that will make successful relationship absolutely obligatory. Yes, sir.
At 7, when a child is in development and their parents, is there such a thing that can bring this on with a person that's being overly protected?
Oh, yes, sir. There's a video, I think there's still a video, of our previous workshop was on parenting, how negative, dysfunctional style of parenting mess our kids up, mm-hmm. and mess us up too, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And overprotective is one. Just real quickly, because you can see somebody afterwards, somebody at the table, they'll steal you to the video. But there's about four of those basic dysfunctional styles of parenting. Mm-hmm. One is overcritical, mm-hmm. one is overprotective, mm-hmm. one is overindulgent, mm-hmm. The other one is over ambitious. These are styles of parenting that's going to mess you up, mess the kid up, mess us up. So yes, you can clearly see how this overcritical style of parenting, you know, where the kid is constantly criticized for doing something wrong, right? Or being at fault for something, so forth, how they're going to try to protect themselves, right? From it. So you can see how it profiles out. The other one that you see in your handout is bronchophobia. Never wrong. Most men suffer from that issue. I have to tell you. Never wrong. Right? Wrongophobia. Which means you are focused in on being right. Now, you can be right or you can be in a relationship. You don't have to decide. You're in a relationship where it's strictly about being right. See my point? Who's right? It's constantly going to be battle. Is this room getting darker or am I just...
Well, okay, the sun keep coming in and out.
Right, I think the sun is down.
Okay, we let it back up.
I got bad eyesight. I got to see these faces here. But this pathological need to be right in your relationship. But there's a reminder of a story about the a guy riding in the town, and this must have been during the cowboy days or something, I don't know, right? And he sees this big fight outside the general store, right? Two guys going at it, you know, knocked down, dragged them out, you see? And so he's curious, right? And so he go over to the crowd, and there's a boy standing in the crowd, and he looks there and says, he says, son, what's going on here? He said, man, this is a real doggone battle fight going on here between my father and this other guy, you see? And then the guy said, oh, that between your father and the other guy? And he said, yes, sir. He said, well, which one is your father? He said, that's what they fighting about. That's what we're doing. We're fighting about who's right. Who's right? Fighting ourselves. Who's right? You're fighting about who's right. Because you are wrongophobic. True? We're fighting about who's at fault. Right? You see? And when these two pathological emotional dispositions become the dominant thing that generates and governs your relationship, then you're going to be fighting all the time about who's right. And you will not succeed in a relationship. A lot more can be said about this. Wrongophobic anger. You've already said something about the victim syndrome. So,
do you want to take a break? They want to take a break.
You want to do a little bit more? Do you have another question?
No, your daughter wants to
take a break. Is that son is too bad if somebody dies?
No, they want to break.
You want to take a break? Okay, let's take a break. What time should we be back? 4 o'clock?
No.
No?
5 minutes.
No, 5 minutes?
5 minutes.
All these women can't go to the water in 5 minutes. Okay, let's say we come
back at quarter to four.
Okay.
All right.
Okay. This, but I've already warned you that there's every possibility. But you got a handbook. There's a website. There's mentors in the room. I don't even know who the mentors are. Raise your hand if I have some anger management mentors. Raise them nice and high. Y'all look around the room and see who they are. So you can draft any one of them to continue to work with you. There's a lot more information. You know, it's about 30 hours of this kind of training. About 30. It takes about 30 hours. But in any case, where did we leave off at?
Page 7.
All right. So there's about five objects of anger. Of anger. I'd say about five. There's several kinds from the visual. But it certainly helps to understand those five kinds of situations. I shouldn't even say objects. It's more like situations where you're going to be challenged to deal with your anger. Okay? Now remember, I'm not saying that because of one get angry that you're a bad person. Please don't misunderstand. Right? Because until you become enlightened, you probably going to continue to get angry about something. Maybe you'll get angry even when you become enlightened, but that's another story. But for sure, pre-enlightenment, you don't get angry. And the problem is not that you're going to get angry. The problem is the mismanagement of the anger, the inability to manage the anger, you see. So we don't want to get it twisted. But there are some circumstances. So the first situation and circumstance where you will be challenged to deal with your anger is our anger at others. And we get angry at others. Because the others, like me, they have their imperfections, shortcomings, and faults, which bound to become a basis for my having a grievance with them. Right? So I'm going to get angry at the other. Who are some of these others? Who do you think you get angry at the most? Let's
my kids.
Kids. All right, kids. Who else?
Siblings.
Spouse. This may be in a descending order. Spouse.
Co-workers.
Co-workers.
Teachers.
Teachers. That's only in high school, right?
No,
I understand.
Spiritual
guys.
They're angry at God. They said they're angry.
Oh, yeah. But God is not an other. Not about an actual other. You know, significant others.
Okay.
I remember we said that most of the violence, crimes, homicide, domestic battery, you see, you're not committing domestic battery against your neighbor or something. You're doing domestic violence. That's some other name. You don't even know.
Well, school teachers come in there too.
Yeah, if you have a relationship with school teachers, but if you know, looking around this crowd in here.
Strangers.
You see.
Neighbors.
Yeah, you could have it with teachers too, but, you know, teachers usually won't fall into a significant other. You know what I mean? It's more like a co-worker type of thing. Or you could say the workplace.
Okay.
That's the same thing. You see? Or someone said what else?
Neighbors.
Neighbors. Yeah, you can have that one. Let's say general population and so forth. But it's not too much, you know what I mean? Because I meet somebody in the elevator going up to the 35th floor, I can be civil and say, because what are we going to be up? We're going to tolerate them for about, 30 seconds? We'll go our way. So casual interactions are not the biggest challenge for us. They're casual, you see? They're not going to last long. Yes, you could have your parents in here. I'm looking for the significant other, because that's where you really have most of your anger, right? Mm-hmm. Right? So, if you don't know how to manage your anger, right? And remember we said you're going to get angry at them. That's given. Why? Because none of these folks on this side is perfect either. We already acknowledge that we're not perfect.
Yeah.
They're not perfect either. We got to factor that in, right? And understand that they're going to do some kids are going to do something that's going to make you angry enough at them to kill them. Right? And some people do kill them because they have no management skills. Sisters and brothers, right? You're going to get angry at one of the sisters and brothers. They're not perfect. Right? Same is the case with your spouse and so forth and so on. And if you don't have the ability to manage the anger, then you're going to go what? Up, right?
Yeah.
You're going to hit some rage, right? And you're going to do something violent in that relationship, right? Now, once you do your violence within the context of these relationships, are these relationships going to get better, or are they going to get worse, or are they going to come to an end?
Come to an end.
Yeah. If you don't manage your anger appropriately at the significant other, you're going to destroy your relationship with that significant other. And these are significant others. They're your support system, right? True? And it's going to destroy those relationships, right? It happens every single day. So we're challenged to manage our anger at others. Now in the handbook you have, there's some techniques for doing that. But one of the most obvious ones is to forgive them. You see? If your spiritual faculty is there, right? Operating. To forgive the kids, you see? Forgive your siblings, forgive your spouse, etc.
Your in-laws.
So forth and so on. Right? And that keeps you from having to suppress your anger. Because anger, when you suppress anger over time, equal rage causes energy. You suppress it. So you have to look at your emotional style now. What do you tend to do with your anger? How do you handle your anger? What do you do with your anger? You see, sometimes one of the things people do with their anger is they go into denial. They deny me altogether. They deny because to acknowledge that they get angry contradicts the image that they have of themselves. They don't want to accept that. So they are substitute the word anger with, well, I don't get angry, but I get a little bit sometimes. I get a little upset. But although it's a euphemism for what?
Anger.
You're angry. You know what I mean? You're just in denial. You follow me? And that's a bad place to be in because you can't manage that which you are in denial of. Right? Another dysfunctional means of managing your anger is you suppress. You suppress the anger. You're angry, but you suppress. You hold it in. You hold it in. Now, what often will happen as a result of you holding that anger in, your whole personality will become distorted. And you become what we call passive aggressive.
Yeah.
Right? Passive aggressive. Right? So you're holding it in, then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, boom, you explode. Or you're holding it in, and that anger makes you feel like what? Burden survivor, right? Exactly, revenge, right? So the passive aggressive person who has suppressed their anger and has turned into this kind of pathology, right? They're very undercover with it. Now they're angry at you, right? But the way that they will express that anger will be like making promise in you. You know what I mean? I'm gonna pick you up from the airport. Don't worry about rental car. I'm gonna pick you up the time your plane gets. You know what I mean? You just come go stand outside the airport. I'll pick you up at on time. And you stand out there and have you pick you up? No, he had no intention of picking you up. Are you with me? Passive aggressive. Are you with me? You see? Passive aggressive. That's how that works. You see? Sabotaging you. So forth and so on. Or you become way angrier than the situation warrants. somebody come in and you take off your shoes and you don't put her back where she tell you to put them. Right? Y'all understand, right? She gonna blow up right in that car. You understand? That you've been angry for 2 weeks at you, and this night you did something wrong. And you're way angrier than the situation was. Suppressed anger. Suppressed. So, and then that's the anger that tears your body up. Are you with me? Because it's not going nowhere. You just suppressed, you got it all down in your leg, up in your shoulder, when you got it in your breast, in your armpits, all in the side of your body, and so forth and so on. Mess you up. It's also what fuels addiction, right? All kinds of abuse, sexual abuse, including pornography, all of that stuff. You see, if you're getting yourself in the then act out, right? You can act it out. Which means you get violent. You see my point? You feel like hitting them, so you just go ahead and hit them. You see, you act it out. Or you just become self. You destroy stuff, you know, you break stuff, and so forth and so on. So forth and so on. But you have to get in touch with your style of having that anger that you're bound to have with other significant others. And we're going to be talking pretty much, since we're talking about the whole personal, intimate relationship, I'm going to kind of emphasize that, you see, because we're talking about how to have successful personal relationship. Well, clearly, you're going to have to learn how to manage your anger against your spouse. You got to get that. You got to get that right. You see, because if you don't handle that one right, that anger will come out in your speech. Actually, first it starts in your voice. As it does all things. Then speech, then your actions. And in that moment of anger, I got to clear my
no.
I'm going to go say something that I'm going to regret.
Yeah.
I'm going to hurt her or hurt him. Aren't I?
Yeah.
I'm going to destroy this relationship. It's not going to work. And don't think you're not going to get angry at your spouse. You see, there's a great myth. People think that human relationships are inherently without conflict. This is nonsense, you see? All human relationships have some conflict. It's inevitable. It's built into the system. Because you, person A, this is person B, you got an entirely different background, where you've been parented, all kinds of, you got different 25,000 hour parenting than you, what they do, blah, 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 blah. It's cross-gender, two different worlds. Bound to be some conflict. Problem's not even the conflict. The problem is the inability to resolve the conflict, which you cannot do unless you have the ability to manage your own anger. It's not going to happen. You see? It's not going to happen. And that's the real deal, folks. You see? People come for marriage counseling, and they're divorcing fundamentally because they can't manage their anger. They cannot manage their emotions. They want somebody else to manage their. But it's your emotions. It's like wanting somebody to breathe for you. How's somebody going to breathe on your behalf? You follow me? Some say, well, give me a prescription. You know what I mean? Give me some medicine. But what medicine is? We can dull your mind, but we can't frighten you. You follow me? All right. And again, I'm going to skip talks. We don't have much time, though. In the handbook, there's appropriate ways to handle this, described in the handbook. So make sure you take away the handbook. Number two, others' anger at us. Again, your spouse is going to get angry. How you going to handle it? You gonna go claustrophobic? You gonna go rumblephobic on them? You gonna present your affection and discount the legitimacy of their grievances? What are you gonna do with that? What's gonna happen? Because you're not perfect. You're not anywhere close to perfect. And some aspect of our imperfection is going to become a legitimate basis for our spouse anger at us. Now, how do we handle that? You ain't supposed to get angry at me. I'm your husband. Is that going to take your anger down or going to take it up? I'm going to ignore your anger at me. You going to be there for me when I get home from work? They're going to get angry at you. How you handle that is going to play a major role. And the success of the relationship. Now the third area, again, I'm kind of glossing these, the handbook and the mentors here. Really make use of the mentors. They have a lot of knowledge. Because these guys have been angry a long time. they're very familiar with all the pitfalls. Okay? Our anger at ourselves. Just good. Because we have anger at ourselves. Because everybody you know told you not to marry him or her. They told you good, right? But did you listen? No, because you thought you were omniscient and all-knowing. You thought that there was no possibility that you could be making a wrong choice in this matter about who you will become lawfully wedded to and so forth and so on. You see? Couldn't tell you nothing, right? Then after a year and a half, you find out he's got, you know, two other families, 12 other kids. Right? Now you're angry at yourself because mama told you not to do it. Papa told you not to do it. Your best friends told you not to do it. But no, you were operating off that ego of yours. But make you think that you can turn water into wine because of who you are. You know what I mean? That you can put some loving on him that will perfect him. You can't go back to your girlfriend and confess, girl, I was a fool. You can't say that because, you know, you were telling me he's the right man for me. Shut up. You see? Now you can't go back. You understand? So you can't. No way out. And you're angry at yourself. Same thing with a man. You see my point? You're angry at yourself when you picked her. You know what I mean? Yeah, she was fine, but she didn't have an ounce of character. Not 1 ounce. Fine. Yeah. Can't manage her nipple. Can't cook. Right? Nothing. You see my point? But you chose, right? You value tits and butts over character. And you did that. I'd be wanting to walk into the club with a fine woman. You see? You know what I mean? Y'all understand what I'm saying? That's what I'm saying. You did that. You used that. And you're becoming angry at yourself because you done used some bad judgment. You done made a bad decision that has come back to create for you a lot of harm. Now you got 3 of his kids, right? Okay. She's got half of your 401k, your house, your chair, the kids. You understand? So you blaming her, she blaming you, but like famous politician Herman King said, blame yourself. So that's what you do, you blame yourself. You're angry at yourself. Now here's the interesting thing. Remember the physics of anger said, whatever you get angry at, you feel like doing what? Harm. So when you're angry at yourself, you're going to become self-destructive.
Yes.
Always.
Yes.
With no exception. Self-destructive. You see? The result of your failure to manage your anger will fill you with self-contempt. So self-contempt is basically you would lose all respect for yourself. You won't respect yourself. And when you lose your self-respect, there's an understanding. You see? So that feeling of self-respect is replaced with self-contempt, and you become self-destructive. You become your own thing.
This is demon.
But this is anger itself, you see? And again, you overestimate it. Your arrogance, your vanity, you overestimate it. You see? You start believing your own hype about yourself and stepped into a situation for which you were woefully inadequately prepared to cope with. You thought you were ready for marriage. You can't do I take thee to be my lawfully wedded wife or husband, you know, with that will send you some help until death do us part. You can't do that. You can't love. You can be attached. You can't love, though, in the different past. You see? And you find that out about yourself. Right? And you get messed up stuff up. You see? Marriage is wrong for them. For real. It's a spiritual process. You see, it's transformative. You follow? It's about learning how to go beyond the limitation of your own selfish impulses for the sake and well-being of the beloved. It's ego transcended by definition. You didn't enter no marriage for that. You were lonely and you were trying to get somebody to make you feel good. When you were broke, trying to get through some stuff. You understand what I'm saying? But it was from a deficit disposition. True. You can't do that. You can't do that. We don't get into this, you see. This is hard. You know, it ain't being bad, though. You know what I mean? And I'm not just saying that from a clinical point of view. I've been married 47 years, you see. The same thing he did, my wife is sitting back there. If you go interview her, she'll tell you she, you know, she almost crazy now. This is the real deal. That's real deal. You see? You can't do 47 years if you don't grow up. That's not possible. In fact, you gotta come through the door, test the box. See, what were we, 20? I was 20, she was 17. So you don't have to be old to be serious, to be wise, you see, and committed, you see. You have to understand what you're doing here. Follow me? Mm-hmm. So I don't have no anger in myself about that. I might have a lot of anger about a lot of other things, but not about that. Anger from the past. Anger at some aspect of the past. Big problem. Because you're angry about something in the past, and you're always trying to go back into the past to correct that. How are you going to go back into the past? Past don't exist no more. It's over. It's gone. It doesn't exist. It's non-existential. Are you with me? And you get obsessed with that, you see? And you can't let that go. Are you with me? And you gotta let this go, you see? So much of the appropriate means for managing our anger depends on our ability to let shit go, you see? Some things ain't worth it. Are you with me? You have to look and see your grievance, how important it is. You gotta ask yourself, how important is this? For me to act on this anger. But, you know, I feel like killing somebody. You see? Now, is this important enough to go off on this person? You see? You gotta ask, how appropriate is it? Am I way angrier than the situation warrants? My anger way up here and the defense is way down there? You see my point? If I'm going to get angry, my stomach going to be hurting, I have headache, I'm going to have insomnia for 2 or 3 days so I can catch up with you. Right? Like all messed up in my mind. You see my point, bitter and cynical. Do I want to put my body, mind, soul for all of that? See what I'm saying? Have you sort of right? And then I got to ask myself, well, even if I do go through all of that, is it going to really modify that reality of the person? Is it really going to change any of the reality? Can you change reality?
No.
No, really, seriously. What is that? If you could change reality, then it ain't reality. True. The other is as much a part of that reality as the weather. Can you change the weather?
No.
Are you going to change your man? Are you going to change your woman? They too are part of the same reality that is the weather. So you're going to get all huffed and puffed up and all that because you're mad because it's 13 below zero. You're huff and puff. And it's still going to be 13 below zero. You'd be done passed out. They're rolling you in the hospital. You got blood pressures out of whack. You understand what I'm saying? Is it worth it? Is it the final thing? Is all of that, is it worth it? You put all that in the past, trying to find out where they might have moved to. You investigated. He used to, if you know so-and-so, so-and-so used to live over there on the second floor. Look, no, we don't know. Okay, thank you. Not going to go. You know, you're trying to go all in the past, trying to fix stuff. You lay awake at night saying, I should have did this. I should have did that. Hell, that was 20 years ago, man. You can't do none of that stuff you're coming up with. You see? Because it don't exist. Right? It don't exist. Or you trying to make some kind of contact and make this person apologize so I can get on with my life.
Why are you going to make them apologize? They may be dead. Now what you going to do?
Dead people can't say, I'm sorry.
Now what you going to do?
You understand what I'm saying? Past. Residual anger is what we call it. You see? Residual anger. Anger that about something that happened in the past, and you have carried it forward into your present, and where there's anger, can there be happiness?
No.
So here, you have forfeited your opportunity to have happiness right here, right now, in the present, because you're not clinging to some residual resentment and anger that you went on when you were 5 years old or something. Do you see the absurdity? You're doing that to yourself. Ain't nobody making you cling to the past. Who making you cling to the past? Ain't nobody doing that to you, is it?
No.
You doing that. You gotta let shit go. You see? Abstract anger. Now this is not even necessarily aimed at any person in particular. You see, you just angry at the way things are, abstract, idealistic. You see? You're angry at the world because the world is not the way you think it should be. And you're full of should. Or something like that.
It's not with that.
It should be like this. You're angry. There should be no racism in the world. What is racism? It's all we do. Okay? You're angry at all black people, all white people. You're angry at all women. You're angry at the weather. You're angry. You're just angry at the way things are. What it really amounts to, you are angry at reality. We can call that reality God. Because God is the only thing that's real. So you look. Word is appropriate. Reality is simply a modification, a manifestation of what you call God. reality. You ain't good reality. You don't want to grow up. You ain't caught your phone over, getting ugly. Well, hey, what the... Blame yourself. You should have ate all that stuff. You do better get it. Should have worked out some. You know what I mean? You understand what I'm saying? You're angry at reality. You're angry at your faith. Why was I born poor? Why didn't I get up silver this morning, mama? Blah, 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 blah. You're angry at reality. And when you're angry at reality, you can't deal with reality. Then your life is going to fit. That's the ultimate relationship, folks, is your relationship with reality. Because everyone and everything that you can be in relationship with is nothing but a manifestation and modification of reality. True? So you got to get real, what we call realism versus idealism, how it should be. You see? People should be perfect. Where you come up with that at? Everybody should hold hands and sing Kumbaya. This is not utopia here. This is not Disney World here. This is planet Earth. This is the world. Birth, death, everything that can go wrong here. You see? You're not going to make your little life a utopian life in the midst of this profound chaos. Get with that. How would you make your life utopic in chaos? And it's even wrong to say chaos. The world has really been falsely accused of being the source of chaos. The world is not the source of chaos. Your mind is the source of your chaos. Are you with me? A mind that is out of alignment with reality. But the ancient Kemetic mystic called, you see, disturbed and torment. It's the mind, it's your mind, not the world. The world is already all right. There's birth, there's death, polarity out there. There's hot, there's cold. If it wasn't these polarities, you could have no experience. How could you experience rest if you never got tired?
Okay.
They're necessary, they're complementary. They're not a tagging from each other. Are you listening? It's your mind. Can't get in harmony with reality. Abstract. Now, a lot more can be said about all of this, folks. I'm really hoping that you take full advantage of this opportunity. This is part of the reason we are having these series of workshops, because we know that oftentimes a lot of this kind of information is certainly not part of our educational curriculum in most of our cases. And yet it's a kind of knowledge we really need, see? Because if you can't develop this kind of successful relationship, how are you going to have a successful family? How is that going to happen? How are your children, see, going to not be affected by the relationship that born into you? Who we can? Are you with me? Some of you in here, your parents were divorced. You know what that means. Scarred you, wounded you. You still care. And the fear, you see, of somebody divorcing you or somebody abandoning you, you see. I understand this stuff. It's not easy stuff. But it is what reality requires of you. Now, y'all gonna stop smiling. Let me turn the page. Did we cover those five briefly?
Yeah.
All right. Now let's go to part two. All right. That's page eight. I'm gonna do my best here. I hate glossing this stuff. I really do. But that's why I said that you need to follow up with one of these mentors here. Four basic emotional needs. Now, the emphasis is need. 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 Because a lot of times we don't put our heart and soul into this love thing. Because you think love is something optional. Nice if I can have it. But it's like an appendix. I can live without it. No. You don't understand enough about yourself to know how bad and how you really need love. That's your emotional need. It's an emotional, psychological, and spiritual need. It's nourishing across the entire spectrum. But maybe before that, no, I'll leave it like that, because everything else is going to be derived from this one need. You see? Just like the body needs food, it needs water, it needs rest. You ain't walking around talking about, I don't need to eat. I know y'all ain't saying that, right? I don't need to drink no water. I don't need no rest. Nobody's that crazy. Nobody trying to pull that off. Nobody trying to pass that nonsense off to somebody else. But we'll walk around and say, I don't need no love. I'm all right. You know, it's a need. It's not optional. It's a need you need. You see? You need it. Without that, you see, you can have all these other kinds of situations, but something is always missing. You know, you can feel it deep down in your soul that you get quiet and get real with yourself, stop bullshitting yourself, you see, and tell yourself the truth, you see. You'll feel it inside you. It's an emptiness. There's a void there. You got life, but you ain't got nobody to share it with. There's no joy. There's no celebration. There's nothing there. You got cars, you got clothes, you got jewelry, you got money, you got all of it, but something missing. You become psychologically and emotionally undernourished. Gotta have love. It's a need, it's not optional. It's a need. It's a need. Love is food that provide the energy that makes your spiritual faculties function. See? See? Love is the energy that gives you the capacity to have empathy, to have compassion, to have tolerance, to have patience, to have forgiveness. Love is the energy that gives you the ability to do all of that. Just like food is what gives you the vital energy to walk. No food. Body can operate. Operates all food, tongue, and breath, so forth and so on. You follow what I'm saying? In the same way, the spiritual, you see, is fueled by this force, this energy called love. These are needs now. Needs, not options. Number two, freedom. Now this is interesting. Freedom is a need. It's a need. It's a psychological and emotional need. You need to be free, to have the experience of being free. Autonomy is freedom. You need that. But here's the paradox in relationship, you see. And this is where we're going to get a little subtle here. We're going to get a little sokai here. Because this is the paradox of relationships, you see. Because what happened is that we move into these relationships with others because we want some love. You see? We're looking to be loved. We're trying to get some food. You understand what I'm saying? Nothing wrong with that. You see? But what happens when we move into these relationships, what we find out, okay, this other person that I'm in relationship with is going to start putting demands on me, my time. Look at the I know you've been trying to explain that, right? I'm going to help you out. You start demanding your time. How you moving your time and space? You see, they start messing with your freedom. And this becomes a paradox now. This is the paradoxia of relationship. This is the paradox of relationship. Okay? I want to get that love, that attention, that affection. But the other is going to start making demands on my time, energy, and attention in such a way that I have no freedom. Not even the freedom to be myself. Are you with me? And so then you say, I'm out of here.
Yeah.
Right? Now you're free again. Right? But now in your freedom, suddenly you start feeling, shit, it's something missing. You start feeling the absence of love. Yes, I'm free. But after a little while, you forget all about that freedom. And you start looking for that love. You want to go back into a relationship. And so that's what you do. You go from relationship to relationship to relationship to relationship to being. You see, you're back and forth. Because what you don't know how to do is to have both of these. That's skill. That's knowledge. But without that knowledge, you only wind up having one or the other. And when you enter into your relationship strictly in search of affection, attention, and love, ain't nothing wrong with that. But the price you may wind up paying is your freedom. And the loss of freedom hurts. You see? It hurts. And so what happened is that the husband or the man, the wife, or the female, you wind up enslaving each other. You see? Right. You move into your relationship with the man to get your love needs met. And he's loving you. But suddenly you discover, this fool is trying to control me. He's trying to dominate you. Right. That's what the male ego does. Right? And since you came here a Buddha, you ain't got much. Right? The male ego seeks to dominate you to the point of veneration, even in the face of the absence of any quality that was born. And that's what you experience. It's domination. Dominates you. Controls you. You see? He demands respect from you without having any quality to it. I'm the man! So he enslaved you. That's how you feel. You feel dominated. You see? You be glad when this bastard go to work. You be glad. Baby, won't you get hired to do another job, baby? You ought to get some overtime. Because at least you ain't around for a moment. Oh, God. She had the freedom to be herself, to enjoy her life. Because, unfortunately, the one we go to for our love wants to be the sole source of your happiness. True?
True.
Wants to be the sole source of your joy. True?
True.
And dominate you and try to control you to that point where he or she becomes the sole source. To become your Lord. To become your God. To become your source. with me. It's deep. And so you see how the woman gets dominated. You see? But the same thing happened to a man. When a man moves into the relationship with the wife, with the woman, to meet that need, because it's a need. It's a need. It's not an option. He didn't talk all that macho shit he wanted. But that ain't real. That's just barbershop talk. You know what I mean? Men go to barbershop and lose their damn mind. So that we be lying about all kinds of things. But the reality is, man, you can go home to your wife. Come on, I'm going to the club. Man, you better get your ass on. I know where you're going. That's the vibe. You want that home to your wife, man. But when a man moves into the relationship with the woman to meet those needs, again, I'm emphasizing the needs now, right? He's going to get something to eat. This is food. This is nourishment. You see? This fills the missing, the voidness. Right? But again, like the female, the wife will take away his free. He becomes henpecked. And every man knows that. He's henpecked, right? I'm reminded of a joke we told this song last time about, you know, in heaven, right? They got two doors, you know what I mean, to enter into heaven, right? So one door is for henpecked men. The other door is for men who are not henpecked, right? So one day this guy shows up in front of the pearly gates to get into heaven, right? And he stands over here. Right? Little old guy, shrivel guy. So St. Peter looks out there and says, man, this is, what's going on? You know, this is strange. Nobody ever stands here. No man. There's never hardly been in the history of mankind any man that came in through this door, right? And besides, the line over here with thousands of people long. You know, he's trying to figure out what's going on here, you see. And so he thought maybe this man couldn't read or something. You know, he has to be illiterate because the sign is big as hell, it's flashing. It's for men who are not handpacked. This is the door for men who are handpacked, okay? Who commenced that? So he comes over, he talks to the guy, and he said, Can you read? Are you sure that you know that you stand at the wrong door? The man says, certainly I can read. I have a Ph.D. I'm a professor of physics. Certainly I can read. He said, well, why are you standing here? Because that's the door, you know, everybody else is going through. And the man said, look, my wife told me when I was down here, you know, stand right here in front of this. No, I don't care if God himself come out here. I ain't moving. Unless I'm... This is what happened to men. This is what women do to men. This is a man's greatest fear. I'm going to become henpecked. That's why they don't want to make a good man. They don't want to have to get in the room in this life, in the knowledge. That all that big talk you've been doing, you just hear without free to be yourself. You know what I mean? Without freedom to enjoy according to your capacity to enjoy. So you see, in this is where it gets slippery here, because that's the paradoxium of relationship. And you have to learn how to handle it. You see? You get here, you can't see no friends, the henpecked man. You can't have no friends. I don't care if you've been here for 30 years. I don't care if y'all have gone to save your life. You can't, you know what I mean? I don't like him. But, and he can't come here. You see my point? Not even the freedom to have your friends. And the same on the other side. You all understand?
Yes.
Anybody that's been in love should understand what I'm saying. Difficult to balance it, you see. And then when this imbalance exists in a relationship, you see, then it's characterized by fighting. Always fighting. Always fighting. Because each person here is trying to resist being a slave. Who wants to be a slave? You see? So there's a resistance, there's a rebellion going, that's deep beneath the threshold of your conscious mind. You see, it's subconscious in you, but something in you is resenting it. You see? We fight against it. You see? So any little thing will do. Any little thing will trigger fight. You follow what I'm saying? You turn to the TV channel, now we're watching it, and it's going to be a fight all night long. Oh, but you were watching a commercial. Well, we're going to fight. And well, I was watching it. Why are you trying to turn from what I wanted to see? And it's going to be a fight. It bothered me more. Deep down inside, he's just fighting to be free. You see? Then after the fight, and they get a little freedom, you sleep on the couch, you sleep upstairs, then the next day, you're back in the bed together again, but now you need to lie. This is how it goes. But these are how the emotional needs that we have, folks, are. A lot more can be said about it. Russian here. Third, safety. Security. It's a need. It's not an option. It's a need. It's a psychological, emotional need. You need to feel safe in your environment, in your space. That's why psychologists have known for a long time you have a space about 24 inches out. They get in their space, there's going to be someone going down, going down. You invaded my space. There's also the same kind of reaction when you invade another person's time. See, it's a time-space, right? It's a time, you see? So when other people invade that, you lose the feeling of safety and security. You see, protection and so forth. And that's a need. It's not a desire. See, you have to understand the distinction between a desire and a need. Desires are optional. Needs don't get met, you perish. That's over. Don't meet the needs of this body disappears, die. Don't take care of the needs of the mind and psychologically and so forth, the mind breaks down. It has this food too. Are you with me? Soul, same thing. These are needs, not desires. You have to enjoy the distinction. How long you just think these are some kind of frivolous desire, you flip it off. You see my point? And your arrogance and your vanity, you walk around pretending that you don't need love and freedom. Who you kidding? Who you kidding? You see? You're deluded. You're bullshitting yourself. That's all you're doing, bullshitting yourself. And the price you will pay is that you will not be happy. No way. You're undernourished. You see? Safety and security. Four, respect. It's a need. There's a need to have a sense of worth and value in spite of your imperfections, shortcomings, and faults. That's a need. That's a need. You need that. You see? Respect. Is a need. Now here's an interesting thing. What most women don't understand about male psychology and male psyche is this one thing here. See, men psychologically experience love differently than women psychologically experience love. And a man, for instance, men, would you rather be alone and unloved by a woman than disrespected by a woman? Now, maybe a couple of y'all should raise y'all hands a little bit like that. You mean just you go rough. But you don't understand, men process the experience of being loved differently. For a man rather be respected than loved in the conventional sense. Because love, he feels love only when he's respected. And when he feels that he's been disrespected, he will shut down. It'll go cold. It's very different. But women need respect too, right? And what men don't understand, a woman processes your love of her via your attention, your affection, pay attention to me, look at me, touch me, be with me. You follow me? Attention. You see? Hold my hand. You see? Attention. You see? Now when she starved, you see, you come home from work and you tired, you did all this overtime, you sitting down and you sitting in front of your TV and turn it on. Now she gonna go crazy. You ain't even seen her all day and she ain't seen you. This fool is watching TV. They're gonna be hell to pay for that. You understand what I'm saying? That's disrespecting the woman. You have to understand, when you don't give your woman attention, she feels disrespected. Unloved. Tell him again, sister. Go ahead, I will. But fundamentally, guys, these are the four basic emotional that every human being has, period. Needs. I'm going to emphasize again, needs, you see? And when you violate this piece here, you know that the marriage can't be a success. But both people need respect. Both people need to have the experience of having worth and value in spite of their individual imperfections or common faults, you see? Now that's the truth, you see? You have to accept that, you see. Now, it's really interesting. I was telling you that Joyce and I have been married 47 years. I showed you how that this works. Because she don't come to these kind of things normally, just because this kind of thing, you see. But she had wrote something to me. She was sharing something with me about apparently the secrets of successful relationship, a successful marriage. She was just showing me. It was a gift, actually. But I noticed that the language she used, you know what I mean? I mean, it's exactly my own assessment of what makes a successful marriage. The ability to accept one another's flaws. You see? Now, that was a very simple summary of what I'm saying here. The ability to accept one another, the imperfections, shortcomings, and flaws. It's what gives you the experience of worth and value. And your ability to accept mine and respect me in spite of that is what gives me the experience of worth and value. And when you give that person that gift of respect, when you give them the gift of freedom and so forth, their love will come rushing towards you like a torrential rain just going down a mountainside. It'll rush towards you. Are you with me? You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Rushes to it. You don't have to do anything. You don't have to ask for it. You don't have to manipulate it. Nothing. You see? Come running toward you. You see? So the greatest gift you can give the other that you're in a relationship with is the gift of love, which is really the gift of freedom, safety, respect. Gifts of love. And then the relationship. Blossom. It's just like this plant side. You give them rain, you give them water, and so forth and so on, they go grow. Same thing. Let's move here. Oh boy, I think we don't make this. I can do this in 15 minutes, but I got anger management mentors in the room, so I can rush through this. They'll pick up for those of you who want. to give a lot more detail. So here, real quickly, then, is the process, the art, if you will, of the psychological and spiritual requirements and prerequisites for successful personal relations. Very simple. First thing you must understand. It all starts with understanding. Because you cannot love someone you don't understand. I know you've been thinking understanding is not necessary in a relationship. No. Understanding is the foundation of a relationship. You can't love nobody that you don't understand. Ponder that. This is deep shit. Ponder that. Ponder that. It's not enough to have a casual attraction for love. That's a casual attraction. That's body stuff. You understand? That's bioenergy, sexual energy, passing between the male and female species. You understand? That ain't enough for a successful relationship. Right? It's just biology. You follow me? You're trying to make relationships strictly on biology. That shit ain't gonna last. Follow what I'm saying? Because it ain't the real deal. Relationship got to first be grounded in understanding. You got to understand the other. You follow what I'm saying? Now, you don't have to lay them on the couch and do a psychoanalysis on this stuff like that, but you got to understand. You see? You got to understand who they are within the context of their developmental history. I hate to use these kind of terms, but they come from a family. If you met their family, you begin to understand them, like the teachers in here, right? Y'all meet these kids' parents, you understand why. You met them in the moment. You smell them, boy, dad, it makes sense now, you see? So understanding the development and history of your spouse, you see, helps you understand, helps you make sense of the behavior so that you don't take it personal. See, it ain't personal. You don't understand, you take it personal. It's not personal. Yet you need to understand. Because you cannot love someone you do not understand. See, that's why we love our kids, but we understand our kids. See, we don't raise them, but I understand. I can love my kids because I understand them. They're my kids. I've done this, you see? You follow me? Right? But your husband is not your kid, your wife is not your kid. So initially, you better understand. You see? You gotta understand. It's the foundation of a relationship. And when you understand, that understanding will generate the love. And that love will generate the respect. And that respect will generate freedom. That's the process in a nutshell. Now, a lot more can be said about all of this. You see? But we started here because if you can't love a human being, how are you going to love God? Come on. Get clear here. Get out of that storefront delusional state. Get out of that mosque delusional state. Get out of that synagogue delusional state. You see, how you gonna do that? You can't love what's right here, right now that you can see. You can't see God. You see? You understand what I'm saying? Love is a prerequisite. Love is what's running this place. You see? Look out there and see how the tree loves the earth. Then love is a love affair. You see? Moonlight is in love with the river that it jumps into. It's love going on. You see? Being pollinated, a rose, that's love. All of this is nothing but the clear love. You have eyes, you will see that. That's why they said God is love. And it starts here. You got to practice. That's what the, that's the beauty of the sadhana of relationships. Sadhana means the spiritual process. The sadhana. It's a sadhana. It's a spiritual process. You see? It's a spiritual process. It's a spiritual training. Because you begin to learn how to love. You begin to learn how to transcend your own ego. You see? Your own selfishness. Your own fixation on yourself for the sake and welfare of the beloved. It's training ground. It's where you come and you learn how to be patient, how to be tolerant, how to be compassionate. You can't learn that from a book. You can't learn it from the Bible. You can't learn it from the Quran. You can't learn it from the Bhagwan Gita. You can't learn it from the Vedas. You can't learn it from the Upanishad. You can't learn it from the Sylvester. You understand what I'm saying? You can't get that from a book. You get that from relationships. Relationship is the context in which you practice your spirituality, not a mosque, not in a temple, in relationship. So love. St. John said it best, love and all else will be added up to you. And if you haven't loved, you've done everything else as if you've done nothing. How would you know when you're not loving? Because your life will feel meaningless, empty, pointless, without purpose. Right. You have not loved. And that meaninglessness, that feeling of without purpose will overtake you. And you're going to blow your brain. You become suicidal. True. You must love. It's not an option. Love or perish. Love or go insane. You choose. But if you choose this side of love, then prepare to be. Be prepared to go through an ordeal. It ain't being bad. It hurts. The transcendence of our ego and our selfishness, that hurts. There's a kind of suffering. Yeah, true. But the suffering of a loving relationship is a suffering that brings all other suffering to an end because it's the springboard. When you get that right, now you are able to go into self-realization, the next level of the journey. You see? Because you're going to find out about yourself in your relationship. Like your husband and your wife will, sooner or later, will start telling you about who you really are. You're going to start pointing that out, and that's what you don't like about it, you see? But they living with you now. They know. They see the contradiction. They see the bullshit. Follow what I'm saying? And they're going to point it out. They're going to step to you with that. And that's fire. You ain't going to like that. Your little ego going to be at risk here. Fire. But if you can stay in the fire, you see my point, and take it, you see? And it helps if you got some meditation, not medication. Meditation. If you got some meditation, you can make it through that process. And then you evolve, blossom. Then you're no longer psychologically dependent on anyone or anything for the sake of being blissfully happy. You see, you don't go over. But you can't get there unless you go through this human process. So you see, we're gifting each other. So y'all go back and get them, call y'all old boyfriend. Y'all got that number? Call your old boyfriend, call your old girlfriend. Or go get you a boyfriend, a girlfriend, and get busy. You see? It's an interesting story about one of the Zen masters, these gurus. And this guy went in search of a guru. He wanted enlightenment and great wisdom. Right? This way he went to the guru and so forth and so on. Gurus asked him questions, right? Interviewed him. To see if he's a worthy candidate for the gift of knowledge. So he's asking this young seeker, you see, of a young man, are you there? The young man said, no. And then the young man, well, why you ask me this? You know, I told you, look at my resume. I'm the real deal. I'm a genuine, bona fide, spiritual teacher. You follow what I'm saying? I'm not into this dating and all of that. I didn't waste no time with that. You follow me? And ask him, listen. Got any good friends that you know? And the guy came with him. He says, why are you asking me this stuff? You should be asking me about how, what was my understanding of the Rukhiya Upanishad? Or what did I understand from reading, you know, the thin of Esther? You see, or what was meant in Genesis? What did Jesus mean in Matthew? He should be asking me these kind of questions, real deep spiritual questions. You know what I mean? Not these silly questions. And so you can imagine this went on. And the master kept asking these silly questions. And finally, he said, well, after a process of elimination, you know, he finally said, well, is you not at least a pet, a parry or something that you love? And the man just frustrated, now he's ready to go, said, this man is a fool. You know what I mean? We've been through this, I'm wasting 2 hours of my time with this stuff. No, I don't love no pet. If the master said, I can't initiate you, you don't have no capacity to love. See, you can't succeed on a spiritual path without the capacity to love. And if you don't love, even if it's risky, and it is risky, there's every possibility you'll get rejected, and that's a lot of people fear. You're afraid of rejection. How are you going to love if you're afraid to love? That's not going to work. Yes, it's a possibility you'll be rejected, but that's the risk. You see? And if you don't love, you will lose the capacity to love. What could be more tragic? You will forfeit that in you which is made in the image of God, which is love. You would have forfeited your own humanity. With that said, we're going to call it a day. Thank you for coming out here. And more than that, I want to definitely thank people out there who made their contribution to our GoFund, which we use to sponsor these series of workshops. Thank you very much. You all made that possible. They made the literature possible and so forth and so on. The room, the whole 10 yards. So I want to thank you all for that. Okay? And we'll have another workshop. And if your name is on the mailing list, do we have a list to stay in touch with people? Okay, we'll keep you posted. Okay? All right. Now, go love somebody.